Good afternoon, everybody. It's Andrew Waters here. I'm from the Annapolis loft with Quantum Sales out in the East Coast of United States. Thanks very much for joining me today. Really appreciate it. And hopefully what I'm about to talk about is useful to everybody, as well as short-handed sailors and couples alike. Before I get into it, though, I hope everyone is coping well with the strange times that we happen to be living in, and like myself, hunkering down and looking for a speedy way back out onto the water, and we look forward to being able to do that. And in the meantime, these talks hopefully will suffice as a second best until that happens. So the thing that I wanted to talk about today was a topic which seems to come up from time to time when couples particularly go sailing, or short-handed sailors, or even sailing with your kids. And it really resonates around the topic of sailing with spinnakers, with your partner, or like I say, kids or short-handed. Quite often, the words, "honey, let's put the kite up," is often met with a certain amount of grimace or intrepidation or past thoughts of screaming, shouting matches and so on and so forth. But hopefully today I'll be able to demonstrate a little bit about why you don't have to go into those scenarios, and really it can be simplified and, more importantly, a really fun experience for everybody. So one of the biggest things that kind of come to play with this, like with many things in sailing, is having good communication, first of all. Having good preparation is also extremely important, but also of significance is to be able to be comfortable in the surroundings that you have and in the environment in which you're sailing in. If either one of you find yourself in an uncomfortable place or not sure about what it is that you want to be doing, then raise the flag and say, "I don't understand that. I'm not sure what I'm supposed to be doing," or whatever the scenario might be. And also, likewise, if the conditions aren't comfortable for you, it's too windy, or it's too wavy, or whatever the case may be, it's very important to get that communication going, have the preparation to execute what it is we're trying to do, and then, like I say, remain within your own comfort zones. Two pieces of equipment that'll go a long way towards making the experience a lot better. Spinnakers are big sails, there's no question about that, but they're also lightweight. But quite often the hardest part about putting a spinnaker up, and taking it down for that matter, is those two parts alone. Putting it up is stressful, can be, shouldn't be, and taking it down is the same thing. So what we do is we introduce a couple of pieces of equipment which will make it so much easier for you. The process is very simple. You'll have the sleeve which is attached to the head of the sail, and it will come all the way down both sides of the sail, the luff and the leech, and it'll join to where the tack and the clue come together. You'll have your tack line on one side, and you'll have your sheet on the other side. Or if it's a symmetrical sail, you have a sheet and your guys on both sides of them. So that's how you'll get the sail when you receive it. And then when you go to hoist the sail, you literally attach the halyard to where the top of the head and the ATN sleeve is, and you pull it up to the top of the mast, leaving everything else down at the bottom. The sleeve will unveil itself, and you've basically got a tube going from the top of the mast down to the bottom, and all you've got left down at the bottom is the tack line, if it's attached to the front where the bowsprit is, or whatever the connecting point where the tack is, and then you've got the sheet, which is on the correct side of the boat for whichever jibe that you want to unveil it. Once you've checked and everyone's all ready to go through the process of unveiling the sail, there'll be a line, like I mentioned in the talk that I did, that goes up through the inside through a tube on the ATN sleeve, round a block, and then come back down again. It's a continuous line, and you start to pull on one end of it so that the sleeve starts to open it up and then unveil the sail. And as you get to about halfway through it, the sail will start to fill, and unveiling the sail will become easier and easier and easier as the sail opens up. You keep going until the sleeve is literally all the way to the top of the mast, and you pull it so that it's all scrunched up at the top, and the sail is bellowed out from there. Okay, If at any point during that process you are not comfortable with what's going on, you stop the unveiling of it and literally reverse the direction, and then the sleeve will come back down. So that's how you bring the sleeve back down. When you're ready to douse the spinnaker, you go back to that same continuous line, pull it in the opposite direction, and what you'll see is that the sleeve will start to come down, and the sail will very quickly, from that rounded sort of shape like this, the shoulders will collapse, and it literally shunt all of the air straight out of the bottom of the sail like that. And it will continue to do that as the sail comes down. And once you've pulled the ATN sleeve all the way back down, you'll have that tube set up again, tack line going out of one side, sheet going out of the other. At that point, all you have to do is lower the halyard, and you literally pull the sail down arm over arm with the tube, place it into the bag, and then you can stow it away again. In terms of how you deploy and set up the roller furling system, again, much like the ATN sleeve, it'll come to you in its prepared state. So it will be rolled up before you go to deploy it. And it's important to make sure that it's rolled up quite tight, just because if you don't do it that way, then wind can get into it and it can start to unravel itself just a little bit. But you should receive that sail in a prepared state. And very simply, what you do is, in exactly the same way you attach the tack to the bow sprit or the front point of the boat, what it's intended to be at, and the sheet is going to be attached to the back of the boat through the blocks that's required. You then hoist the full roll sail, making sure that you go on the outside of the Genoa sheets and on the outside of the headstay. You hoist the full rolled up sail, so again, it's like a tube, it goes straight up over onto the top of the mast, and you get full tension coming down. And make sure that you have that tension in the halyard correct, or in the tack line to adjust it, so you've got really, really solid tension in that torsion cable line. Once you're up and you're ready to go, there's a furling line. So like the ATN sleeve goes up and down, this continuous furling line from the top down furler just goes in a fore and aft motion that runs to the back of the boat or a mid-deck point. And when you're ready, it's very straightforward, the furling unit. In this particular case, when you're ready, you pull on the sheet and just make sure that the sail unrolls itself through the continuous line. It unwraps and it comes out, and away you go. And on the furling up of it, it's exactly the same, exactly the opposite. You ease the sheet, you start rolling the sail in. And sometimes it's quite important to what we call flag the sail. Really, really let a lot of that sail out, so the sail starts to kind of flutter in the luff area. Then you roll it up, and then as the sail comes kind of through its halfway point, you might want to take a little bit of tension on the sheet just to make sure that you get a nice tight wrap as you bring it back in. Once you've got it furled up again, the sail is rolled and it's still up in its vertical position up and down the mast. And when you're ready, you just lower the halyard, and the same thing, you just kind of bring it in hand for hand, disconnect the tack, disconnect the sheet, put it into its turtle, stow it away. Ready for the next time. Downwind running sails and what we call round luft sails. That if we do have sails which are more for reaching, which are flatter cutted sails, or straight luft sails, which typically you might find are a code zero. And for those sails, we can use something different. It's called a furling unit, a top-down furling unit, which is common in racing boats, but it's also becoming a lot more common in cruising boats. And our designer last week, Adrian, talked specifically about the reaching sail, the code zero. So I'm not going to go too much into that, but the mechanism of the top-down furler on a code zero, the cable goes inside the luff of the sail. So it literally runs up just like your head sail, your Genoa, and the sail can roll around on the spindle itself. Now, I've got some video footage here which kind of shows the simplicity of being able to roll the sail up using one of these top-down furling units. And on a final note of the two different options that we can use, an ATN sleeve is very much more diverse in its application than you would find in the top-down furling unit. So the ATN can be used in almost any single spinnaker, whether it's an asymmetric spinnaker or whether it's a symmetric spinnaker. Whereas the top-down furler doesn't necessarily cross over in all aspects of that. The last thing is that the ATN sleeve is potentially quite a bit more cost-effective as well. So it does provide quite a lot of diversity, and certainly something that we tend to look at when we're looking at running type of sails. So once we've determined what it is, which option we want to go to, whether it be the sleeve or we go down to the top-down furling, that's a conversation that you really need to have with your sail maker at your loft about which is your best option. Once you've decided that, then we kind of go into the setup of it. And like I've said, the preparation and the setup is particularly important because once you're trying to put the sail up, if the sheets are run in the wrong place or the halyards on the wrong side of the forestay or a number of things, the sheets are run through the block the wrong way, things can unravel fairly quickly. And the joyful experience really that you're looking for of putting the spinnaker up and having fun goes away quickly. So we're going to try and avoid that. So make sure that the lines are run in the correct manner, sheets outside of shrouds, run through blocks at the back of the boat the right way, tack lines if you have them, run to the back of the boat correctly, or at least tie down to where they need to be, mid deck or somewhere like that. Make sure that the halyard is on the right side of the correct side of the forestay for which jibe you want to set the sail up for, and all just basic things like that. If you have got a symmetrical sail, make sure that the guy is into the pole end. Make sure that the pole is set up on the correct height on the mast and on the outboard end of the pole. Make sure that the downhaul or the fore guy is secured, and make sure the topping lift is secured as well. So we've got all of these processes done ahead of time. And before we decide to raise a sail or do anything, final checks going backwards and forwards. If it is your partner that's back there or the kids that are going to be manning the sheets, if you have an autopilot, make sure the autopilot's on. Ask the final questions. Are we comfortable? Are we happy? Are we ready to go? Make sure that the boat is at the right angle to the wind that you want it to be, 140, 150 degrees to the wind. It's going to make raising the sail so much easier. So that's really what it's all about in terms of the setup. And again, just to reiterate, if you are uncomfortable at any time, avoid that argument, avoid that doubt, and just simply say, wait, stop. And I've got a question about that. What am I supposed to do about this? What am I supposed to do about that? Okay. So that's the that's really the in terms of the setup. The execution of it then kind of falls in its own way. If you're using a sleeve, you put the sail to the top of the mast, just like I've spoken about. Do a check backwards and forwards. Are we all still okay? And then, you know, quite simply, like I've said, unveil the sail quite slowly and easily. If you are using a top-down furling unit, it's very important to make sure that once you've got the sail up on the furling unit, that you get the halyard tension or the tack type tension. So we've got tension in the torsional cable, or at least in the luff. Once you're ready to do that, try to control the sail a little bit more as it unfurls itself, as opposed to just letting it completely free spin. If you can, then that would be a good thing as well. If, however, it does kind of just spin out of control, which sometimes it can do, don't worry, let it do it. If you're in the right place with the right angle, then you'll be able to fill the sail, the sheet will set up, no problem at all. Okay, so it is really all about communication. It is all about setup, so picking the right equipment for the right sail. And then once you've got all of those things in place, as you've seen from the photo that we showed you before, big sails, you go fast downwind, and whether you're cruising or going out for a family fun day of racing, they knock off miles pretty quickly, and everyone will be able to have a lot of fun. So it's a pretty simple process, and with that, I think what we're going to do is probably move to a question and answer scenario, because that's probably where we'll get most of the benefit of this. If you guys got questions because you tried this before, had problems, see if we can find a solution for it. Alternatively, if you've got a spinnaker which has been sitting in a locker or in a storage facility for a long time, you don't know whether you want to use it or not, or you're intimidated by using it, ask a couple of questions here, see if we can get some answers for you. Alternatively, if you have got some experiences that you've been through, share those with us as well, and we'll see if we can come up with a suggestion or two to try something a little bit different. So if we've got any questions, I'll just have a little wait and see what might pop up here. It's a good question. So the question from Scott is, do you have to have a prod to fly an asymmetrical sail? The straight answer to that is no, you really don't have to have a prod, but sometimes you'll find it a lot easier. The purpose of the prod or the bowsprit is to get the tack separated from the genoa and get some separation between the genoa, which is potentially furled up, or at least the head stay, and get some breathing space so that the sail can fly a little further away from the sail. It also makes it quite a bit easier when you jibing comes into play, because the sail has the ability to be able to pass between the forestay and its own placing. Now, I said you don't have to have it. You really don't. You can place the tack on a secured point, but it's got to be in front of the genoa, and you've got to have enough space for the sail to be able to fly free. If you've got a high flying pulpit, you might want to put a pennant onto it so it flies above the pulpit so it can't get caught on certain things. But you don't actually have to have a prod, although some might argue that it's a little bit easier if you do. So the next question is, what's the deepest true wind angle without a prod? Well, a little bit of that is going to depend upon the sail that you've got. There are different sails which will allow you to sail deeper, and there are other sails that won't allow you quite to sail so deep. But I think probably the most important thing in this aspect here is it really as comfortable as you dare. You don't want to go completely dead downwind, because the mainsail is going to blanket the sail. So I would say somewhere in the region of about 165 to 170 degrees. But remember as well, you'll be able to fly these things in different wind strengths at different angles. So that's quite important to touch on as well. Some people consider flying a sail in less wind is easier. It often isn't. Sometimes it's a little bit harder. But again, going back to that comfort zone that you'll develop and you'll build up as a couple or as a shorthanded group, start sailing, if you're not too comfortable, in very steady sort of 8, maybe 10 or 12 knots of wind, and build it up a little bit as time goes on. You'll find that with your processes that you do, you'll get more proficient at it and you get more comfortable at it. But certainly, the wind ranges, you can get down to about 165 fairly comfortably with the right type of sail. Next question is, if you're shorthanded sailing with a family or without your partner a lot, is there a way to optimize the setup of the boat to make it easier? Yeah, there is. There's lots of different ways to set up the boat, but certainly if you're shorthanded, you want to simplify things as much as you possibly can. One of the ways to do that is to make sure that all of the lines, be that the halyard, be that a tack line or a downhaul, sheets obviously already go back there, but try to run everything back in a very, very simplistic and organized manner in the cockpit. Because once you've got everything back there, it's very easy. Really, at the end of the day, with these systems that we're talking about, you're operating a halyard before you're doing anything else, because you'll have the tack line set up, you'll have the sheet lines all set up. Then you hoist the sail, you can stop, you can pause, make sure that everything else is in place, and then you can deploy the sail, at which point, by that stage, all you actually need to control is the sheet. So being organized and having everything back in the cockpit is certainly going to help. So another thing that I'll touch on here whilst we're waiting on the next question to come on through, this is actually a document that I put together a couple of years ago, and if you go to our website, quantumsails.com, you'll be able to see that. So you'll be able to run back to this thing and just rerun through it. But also once we've passed through this period and we're all allowed out to go and play on our boats and stuff like that, we'll be able to get back into the lofts and so on and so forth. And like I say, I'm in the Annapolis area. And if there's a group of you that are interested in putting something together, a little bit more of a live demonstration, I'd be happy to set that up in the Annapolis loft at some point and get everyone around either on an evening or on a weekend when the loft isn't quite so busy. And we'll be able to set up a spinnaker with an ATN sleeve in place and show you the whole deployment of it in and out. And we we'll also be able to do that with a furling unit as well. So it helps to visualize and go through the processes of how these mechanisms work. Next question is, what is the most versatile, easiest sail you would recommend for cruising couples? So that's a great question, because really at the end of the day, most people will probably, if they're going to pick a downwind sail, they're going to pick one. They're not that, it's not really that likely that you'll end up picking two or three sails, because it, at the end of the day, if you're going to use the sail, you're probably going to use it when you are running the most. So a running sail is probably the best. As an asymmetric, we would call it an A2 or an S2 in a symmetric type environment. So when you speak to your sailmaker expert, when you really speak to him about or her about the spinnaker that you're looking for, they're probably going to default to go into a running type of sail, which gets you the deeper angles, and really it gives you the most benefits in terms of being able to make passage very comfortably and very easily. And you can do some reaching with it, but it's much more of a running sail. So I that's the one I would suggest that you go with. Okay, so the next question we've got is it better to have your head sail out when flying the kite? Probably not. The whole purpose of this is to make it as simple as we possibly can. There's certainly different aspects when we talk about racing that you might have different sails up on the head of the sail. But in this particular case, really simplicity is what's going to prevail. So before you do any of this, you really want to make sure that you've turned the boat to the angle that you want to sail at, be it a passage, a compass course, or whatever that might be. And you know that you've got the wind angle set at the right right position for the boat. The mainsail's already been released, which in turn is going to help blanket the sail for the spinnaker, that is, when you unveil it. So no, I don't think you want to have another head sail out at this time. You want to get that rolled away, out of the way, clear the deck, so to speak, and really get things as simple as you can possibly make them before you unveil your spinnaker. Simplicity is going to be key here. Okay, so we've got another question. What's the difference between an A1 or a G1, an AP, Jenica? So again, into the complexities of what we can do in terms of sail making, these are all sort of off the wind type of sails, as opposed to your Genoa or your jib, which is designed specifically to take you upwind. So an A1, an A2, an A3 are all asymmetrical spinnakers, and they do different things. Like I've mentioned, an A2 is typically a running sail, an A1 and an A3 is a little bit more reaching or heavier air, because it's just cut it just a little bit flatter. So it's all doing the same thing to get us to move downwind, but the sail shapes are slightly different. An AP Jenica. Now, a Jenica is something which is slightly different again. Typically, we would use a Jenica, or it can be called a screecher, on cruising multi hulls. It works for a lot of the same thing. These are sails, typically nylon sails, that are designed to get you downwind. When we start talking about G1s and different sails like that, it's very much more into a racing type of terminology. And that's really like a much, much larger Genoa Code Zero, designed to kind of go upwind. But it's getting a little bit more tricky and more technical in those aspects. And we're trying to focus upon the couple going cruising and keeping things as simple as we can with a single downwind sail. Okay, the difference between a racing and a cruising Code Zero. That's a fairly reasonable question. And not a lot is probably the answer. In terms of the sail shapes that we're using, about the same. You might be using different fabrics and different materials. And in a cruising sail, we'd certainly want to make it as durable as we possibly can. And to do that, we'd probably we'd put a skin on it, or we put a lightweight taffeta on it, which will just add to the durability that the sail will get, where it's less susceptible to damage, tears, abrasions, those sort of things. But in terms of the purpose of them, they're doing much the same sort of thing. They're going to provide the boat that you're sailing on with the best possible chance to go reaching or close reaching, depending on what the wind strength is at any given time. Okay, we've got another one that's coming in from here. Oh, this is great. This is wonderful. Hey, Bill, how are you? A client of mine who's actually, he's out in the Pacific Ocean right now. And we built him a sail. We built him an A2. And it's great. So he used it. He got a little bit damage on it, which can happen. And he's got it repaired. But he's used it sparingly. But it's nice to hear from you, Bill. Thank you. Yeah. So I do wonder a little bit. I went out with Bill on his boat, and we used the sail quite a few times, or deployed it a few times, I should say. And unfortunately, had some difficulties with it. But hopefully, emphasis on practice and preparation that might help out. And good luck in the future there, Bill. Okay, so back to a previous question. The question that I have now is it recommended to add a prod to a boat without one? So it's a good question, and it might well be. And a bunch of different things will come into play with that. Accessibility to being able to put a bowsprit onto a boat is something that you'd need to look at with your riggers and your sail makers, because anchors can get in the way, anchor lockers can get into the way. But certainly, I think there'll be benefits to the application of flying an asymmetric downwind sail if you do have a bowsprit. Certainly for the reasons that I mentioned before, but I think as well that you'll probably find it a lot easier, and it'd be less problematic, particularly if you're sailing shorthanded. So I think if budgetary means allow for it, and then the application in the bow area allows for it, you certainly could. And there are bowsprits that are out there. Selden make one which is retractable, and they're relatively inexpensive, and because they can retract, they can get stowed down on the deck relatively easier. So I think there is benefit in it, but like I said before, it isn't absolutely necessary. But again, speak to your sailmaking expert, and they'll be able to advise you better whether you need one as opposed to whether you want one. So I've got another question about, can I talk about the best setup for a top-down furling spinnakers? I've touched on it just a little bit. In terms of the best setup for a top-down furling spinnaker, is there's many, many out there. A lot of the rigging companies make them, and they you know, at the end of the day, they're all serving the same purpose. Perhaps one of the most important factors in terms of furling sails is the torsional cable. So certainly, again, speak to your rigger or speak to your sailmaking expert about the torsional cable and how they're all put together. But when you talk about the setup for the top-down furling in spinnakers, the tricky part is that which is a spinnaker that's furling is different to a Code Zero, which is furling, because, like I've mentioned, the torsional cable runs through the sail itself. And I think we've got some diagrams on our website of just how different it is when you have a round luff sail or a loose luffed sail in the furling unit, because you're trying to grab a lot more of the sail to get furled up, which is different to the sleeve, which just all gets encompassed inside the sleeve. So certainly, again, going back to your sailmaking expert and taking the best advice in the setup of whether a top-down furling unit for your spinnaker is better, or if you're better to go with a sleeve. I would suggest that probably more often than not, you'd end up going with a sleeve. So I've got another question. Are there any drills or preemptive measures that a shorthanded crew should use to prepare for a smooth hoist? And it looks like the question is relating to hoisting without a pole. So there are preemptive, and it all just comes right back to the preparation. You've got to be able to know comfortably that all of your lines are run corrective. And you can do it at the dock, or you can do it before you actually go sailing. But preemptive measures in the shorthand aspect of things, it's communication. You've really, because it's very simple. You're attaching three lines to three corners of a sail. Once they're attached correctly and all the lines are run accurately as well through the blocks and so on and so forth, that's really your preemptive maneuvers. And then no surprises is the next thing. So just if you're working on the foredeck and you're ready to hoist the sail, doesn't necessarily mean that the person manning the sheets or the helm or whatever it might be at the back of the boat is ready as well. So communication, that really adds all together with the preparedness and the preemptiveness. Okay, the next question that I've got is how do you keep the spinnaker from twisting inside the sock over multiple uses? And it's backed up by, I find that I have to lay it out from time to time. I think the thing is that once you put the spinnaker up inside of the ATN sleeve, it's quite important to make sure that the line, because the continuous line will, one part of it will run up inside of the sleeve, then it'll go to a block at the top, it'll run, and then the other part of it will run on the outside of that ATN sleeve. When you've hoisted the sail, you see the head of the sail starts to turn. Before you try to unravel it or deploy it or anything like that, see if you can rotate that back around so the sleeve is a continuous not wrapped up at any point in the process. I think if you do that and the sail unveils itself and opens up smoothly and easily, when you bring it back down, it will do exactly the same. But again, just before you pack it away, just do a check up above to make sure that the sleeve itself is all smooth and that the sail is inside it. I think that'll help you a great deal. And if it isn't, and you do have to bring it down in a hurry, unrolling it as you pack it away is also a possibility as well. Remember, you can always twist the head as you're packing it back into the bag and just make sure that sleeve is smooth from the head down to the base of the ATN sleeve. With the sleeve, well, there's two ways. You can. If we're talking an asymmetric spinnaker, it's going to depend on the size of the boat and a few factors in that regard as to whether you do what we call an inside jibe or an outside jibe. But that would be just a more conventional jibe to make sure that the sail either passes around the outside of itself and then back over onto the other the opposite side of the boat, or if it passes inside itself between the headstay and its own luff. That's just very conventional, and that's probably how you would jibe the sail if you had a sleeve on or not. And the same with an asymmetric. If you've got a spinnaker pole, you either need a dip pole jibe through the fore triangle, or you need to end to end and switch the pole over to the other side. But remember, with your sleeve at any time, you can just pull the sleeve down, cover the sail up, and like I say, literally just manhandle the sail around to the other side of the boat and unveil it on the opposite side. Very, very simple, very safe. And you can do that in probably much stronger winds than you would feel a lot more comfortable in without dousing the sail before you do that. So again, I know I keep emphasizing it, but it's about communication. It's about the preparation, and it's about your own comfort zone. If you're not comfortable about jibing a sail whilst it's unveiled, you use an ATN sleeve or a dousing sock, and you literally douse the sail, swing the sail over into the other side of the boat, go through all your preparation checks, communication, and unveil it just like you're hoisting it for the first time. Make it simple. Okay, I'm not sure if we've got any more questions coming through. We'll give it another minute. No, that looks like it might be it. And with that, I'll thank you all for joining me. Like I said, I believe my details are all available for anybody who's got any questions. I'm open all times, but particularly this time, for any phone calls or any emails that you with questions that you may have. Or like I say, if you've got an interest, let me know, and we'll see about setting up some kind of a live demonstration in the Annapolis loft when we can all get back out there and do things again. So thanks very much for tuning in again. Like I say, this particular topic is on the quantumsails.com website, so go and have a little look at that, and please be safe, take care of one another, and thanks for joining. Okay.